Hello friends, welcome to Dr. Sai Physiology Academy, DOPA for short. This is the place where we make the learning of physiology easy, exciting, and effective. Thank you for joining me. If you're new to this channel, you're specially welcome. And if you love the content that we share, kindly click the like button and also the subscribe button. And don't forget to turn on notifications so you don't get to miss any new content that we drop. Now let's get started. So this is the part two of introduction to endocrine physiology. So now we're going a step further, and something very important is knowing how do hormones become physiological actions. Because you have hormones that are there to do what? To coordinate and to elicit physiological responses. They help to integrate several physiological processes to make sure that there is homeostasis, there is balance. So, but the thing you need to ask yourself is, how does the binding, this is showing you the steps. What we're going to be dealing today is the mechanism of hormonal action. How does the binding of a hormone to each receptor lead to physiological responses? And we mentioned some of those physiological, what we term physiological responses. It could just mean cell division, okay? Cell division. A hormone is a signal, it's sending a signal, okay? A hormone is a chemical messenger, don't ever forget. It's a chemical messenger. It carries what? A message, a signal. So how does a signal lead to things like cell division? How does it convert that message into a physiological response? Cell division, it could be cell differentiation. Differentiation. It could be muscle contraction. It could also be secretion. A hormone can stimulate some cells to secrete. Okay, something like secretin is a gastrointestinal hormone. It stimulates certain cells of the GIT to secrete their substances. Okay, it could be secretion. It could also be even cell death. And most importantly, to regulation of levels of either nutrients or electrolytes, like all those sodium and calcium levels, and so on and so forth. So these are different kinds of physiological responses. So what we're going to be dealing with today is, how does a signal, a message, becomes transformed into this? What are the processes? That's what mechanism of action of a hormone. When you say the mechanism of action, that's what you're talking about. And it is usually termed, referred to as signal transduction. Okay, signal transduction. The word transduction is talking about the conversion of signal to physiological response. Generally, transduction means the conversion of one energy to another. But in physiology, when we say signal transduction, we are referring to the conversion of a signal or a stimulus into a physiological response. All right, so signal transduction, mechanism of action, they mean the same thing in this respect. So now let us start. Now, first thing you need to know is that a very important principle of physiology is that proteins are the structural and functional molecules of the cell. A lot of all these physiological responses that I have seen, they are carried out by proteins. You have structural proteins, you have functional proteins. For example, receptors, they are proteins themselves. Another thing too, enzymes that catalyze so many chemical reactions, they are proteins. Okay? So first of all, let us start with the very first step in the signal transduction. We call it signal transduction pathway. Okay, so the very first step is a hormone binding to your receptor. And there are two types of receptors. We'll start with that. Let us remind ourselves of those two types of receptors, because it will determine how the signal transduction pathway will happen. Now, you have the plasma membrane receptor. Plasma membrane receptors. Okay? Then number two, you have intracellular receptors. Okay? The difference is very simple. Plasma membrane receptors, they are receptors that bind to water-soluble hormones. This is the cell membrane, okay? The hormones are water-soluble. And because there is a lot of lipid in this hormone, lipid bilayer, the thickness of this hormone, of this cell membrane is lipid. It cannot cross through, okay? Water-soluble cannot cross through lipid. So, it cannot get into the cell, because where the action needs to happen, all the physiological actions, they are inside the cell. So since it cannot get into, their receptors are positioned at the cell membrane. Okay? So it's water soluble. And we also said, when we're classifying the hormones, we said that though a lot of those protein or peptide hormones, all of them, all the pituitary hormones, parathyroid hormones, insulin and so on, they're all protein hormones, they are all water soluble. And also catecholamines of the amine group, okay? So all these ones, they have their receptors there. So they have a certain way that their signals are transduced or converted. Then intracellular receptors, they also have their own way. They can be located in the cytoplasm or in the nucleus. And the main one that is widely recognized to have this receptor in the nucleus is thyroid hormones, thyroxine and so on. Their receptors are in the nucleus itself. So now let us mention the receptors, and we will now mention how they lead to physiological responses. So in the plasma membrane receptors, one of them is what we call ion channel linked receptors. Okay, then number two, you have enzyme linked receptors. Okay, enzyme linked receptors. Then number three, you have G protein. Gene protein coupled receptors. Okay, so these are the three types of the plasma membrane receptors. Why this one? Like I've mentioned, you have the cytoplasmic receptors, and you have the nuclear receptors. So we're going to be talking about them one after the other. Ion channel linked receptors, what are they talking about? What happens is that when the hormone binds to the receptor, their receptors are linked to ion channels. Do you understand? They are linked. You have the receptor is joined to a specific ion channel, so that when the hormone binds to the receptor, what happens? A conformational change. Proteins, one of their very special characteristics is their conformational change based on the condition, different conditions. Now in this condition, when a hormone binds, there's a conformational change that can either open the ion channel or close the ion channel, and which will now lead to influx of the ions that should pass there. Or when it closes it, it stops the flow of ions. And the flow of ions, they can stimulate membrane potentials and so on and so forth, that will lead to physical. Let me give you a very good example. A good example of this ion channeling receptors are epinephrine. Remember, adrenal medullary hormones, epinephrine and norepinephrine. Epinephrine. Okay? They are very good examples of these ion channel receptors. Remember that epinephrine is a neurotransmitter. Okay? It's also a neurotransmitter. It's a neurotransmitter. They are sympathetic nerves. They release this epinephrine. It's just that adrenal medullary hormone, they release this epinephrine in the form of hormones into the bloodstream. While in the sympathetic one, is from nerves. So they are neurotransmitters. So the same thing, if you understand how acetylcholine works, acetylcholine will be released. It will bind to its acetylcholine receptors, and it opens up, for example, sodium channel. Sodium enters, it leads to generation of membrane potential that now, in the case of a muscle, it activates the muscle, the contractile mechanism. Remember also how the process works, actin and myosin. That membrane potential will now lead to release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum that will bind to troponin C, that will change the shape and remove the inhibition of troponin T on actin. So actin will now be free to now be attracted to myosin, and they slide together, which leads to muscle contraction. So the muscle contraction is now the physiological action. You see the process. So this is how this ion channel, the flow of ions lead to different processes that activate proteins, myosin, actin, they are proteins. You see how they lead to muscle contraction. So that's just how they function. The receptor itself is linked to an ion channel. So that's how that one functions. Then the next one, mechanism of action, signal transduction, enzyme-linked receptors. These ones, the receptors are either linked to enzymes or they themselves are enzymes. And of course, when the hormone binds to the receptor, it activates the enzymes. So the activation of that enzymes will activate some other enzymes, especially there are some enzymes that are known as kinases. They are very involved in signal transduction. Kinases are enzymes that do what they phosphorylate proteins. Okay, usually phosphorylation of proteins activates them to function, activates them, they change their conformational shape and so on. Conformational change happens and physiological actions can be cell division. Remember that actin, for example, is a protein, it's a structural protein. And when we talked about actin, under general physiology, under cell structures and all of that, cytoskeleton, actin is a cytoskeleton, also known as microfilament. Okay, it's involved in cell division. You see that? So that's how these things, they work. Proteins. Once proteins are activated, they lead to different reactions. And a good example now of enzyme-linked receptor is insulin. This one is insulin. Insulin functions through the use of enzyme-linked receptors. Another one is growth hormone. Growth hormone and insulin, they are very well known. They use this enzyme-linked receptor mechanism. Then the one that is most common, the ogakpatapata of them all, is the G protein coupled receptor. In fact, that's the one we drew in this place now. The G protein coupled receptors, they are more abundant. And now, very easy way to remember the hormones that are involved in this G protein. You know, the pituitary gland has 8 hormones. The pituitary gland, it secretes 8 hormones. Out of those 8, only 2 are not involved in this, don't use this G protein receptors. The remaining 6, they use this G protein coupled receptors to transduce signals. Okay? And the 2 are growth hormone and prolactin. So apart from growth hormone and prolactin, all others, ACTH, TSH, FSH, LH, all of them. So except growth hormone and prolactin. So just use that to remember. All the other pituitary hormones, they are G protein coupled receptors. And then how do they transduce their own mechanism? It's a little more complex than the rest, but we'll make it very simple. Okay, now look at what happens when you talk about G protein. G protein actually means guanosine. First of all, there's what we call GTP, guanosine triphosphate. Okay, guanosine triphosphate binding protein. So that's what is known as G protein. So whenever you hear G protein, that's what it means. Don't get confused. Okay, guanosine triphosphate binding protein. So that is this green structure you are seeing here. It binds GTP, guanosine triphosphate binding protein. Okay, so now this is what happens. It goes through several steps. There are two broad mechanisms or second messenger mechanism. They use what to call second messengers. These G protein coupled receptors, they make use of what we call second messengers a lot. And there are two second messenger systems or mechanisms. Okay, one of them is the adenylyl cyclase mechanism. Another one is the phospholipase C. Okay, let's write it somewhere here. So this is GTP, okay, second messenger system. One, adenylyl cyclase mechanism. Another one is phospholipase. Don't worry, you understand it. Phospholipase C. Okay, so these two, they are known as effector. They are enzymes, so effector proteins. Okay, so let's explain it now. All right, so what happens is that the hormone binds to the receptor. Usually it's about 6-7 steps. Okay, let's write them here. Okay, so this step one is that there is binding of the hormone to its receptor to form hormone receptor complex. You have the hormone receptor complex is formed. Number two, when it binds, then this G protein, okay, is linked to the receptor. All right, so this G protein, one thing about it is that it binds GTP. That's why it's called G protein. But this GTP, sometimes it can be GDP. When it binds GDP is when it's in the inactive state. That's when there is no hormone binding to the receptor. Instead of GTP, it is GDP, guanosine diphosphate. Okay, and that guanosine diphosphate has three subunits. You have the alpha subunit, the beta subunit, and the gamma subunit. Okay, so boys, this beta and gamma subunit are just stable, but this alpha subunit is the one that moves around, that changes. Okay, so when a hormone binds to this receptor, a conformational change happens that activates the G protein. Okay, so there's activation of the G protein. The activation of the G protein causes a release of this alpha subunit. The alpha subunit binds to GTP. Once it's activated, GTP now binds instead of GDP. Remember, GDP is the stable inactive state. Once a hormone binds, GTP comes and binds to it and then carries this alpha subunit away. Okay, so The next thing is that GTP and alpha, joint with alpha subunit is released from it. So when it's released, what does it do? It now goes, and this thing is called adenylyl cyclase. Okay, adenylyl cyclase is an enzyme, very big, prominent enzyme. So number four is what? The activation. It's an enzyme, activation of adenylyl, let's write it AC, adenylyl cyclase. And what happens next? Number five. You see it here. Adenylyl cyclase, what it does is that it breaks down ATP. Breaks down ATP to form CAMP. CAMP. You can call it CAMP for short. Adenylyl cyclase. It's called cyclic adenosine monophosphate. From adenosine triphosphate, it now becomes cyclic adenosine monophosphate. Okay? So it means formation. Number five, step five, formation of CAMP, cyclic AMP. That's in fifth step. So this cyclic AMP is what is the second messenger that we talk about. The second messenger. What does it do? It goes now. This thing here is called protein kinase A. Protein kinase A. So number six is the what? Activation of protein kinase A. You'll be wondering all these plenty steps. Why? I can't just go once and just activate the final this thing. Activation of protein kinase A. Let's say PKA. Then the number seven step is what? Phosphorylation. No, I said that kinases, they are enzymes that phosphorylate proteins. It now leads to phosphorylation of proteins in the cell. Phosphorylation of proteins. Then phosphorylation of proteins now leads to these two things, are they mean the physiological response. Phosphorylation of proteins, they lead to the physiological response. Proteins behind physiological responses. So the phosphorylation of protein activates the protein, it changes conformational shape and so on, and leads to. So these are the steps. Just memorize them and meditate on them. Okay? This is the second messenger, CAMP. So the other one, phospholipase C, is very similar. It's just names. Instead of this adenylyl cyclase, now you now have phospholipase C. Instead of CAMP, you have what is known as DAG, diacylglycerol plus IP3, inositol triphosphate. So it breaks them down. Okay? It leads to formation of calcium also. So instead of protein kinase A, it's now protein kinase C. So it's just the name that changes, but the same pattern, the same steps involved. So you wonder, okay, why can't this hormone just bind to this and then it activates directly the proteins? Why all this 1, 2, 3, going step by step by before? Why all this long, this thing? I'm going to tell you the reason, okay? I'm going to show you a very short video that you're going to watch, and then we'll go on a break, and I'll tell you the reason why you have many steps like this after this break.
And the smallest domino is about 5 millimeters high and 1 millimeter thick, and I will carefully place it. And there are 13 dominoes, and the largest domino, it weighs about 100 pounds and is more than a meter tall. Ready? Boom.
All right, you're welcome back. Now, you've watched that video, all right? And what did you notice? The domino effect. The domino effect. And you saw how a small tile like this led to the bringing down of a bigger tire weighing several kilograms. Very heavy. Ordinarily, if you carry that small tire to fall on that big tire, it will not have any effect. So you see how something small led to something big. That is why you have several steps. It leads to the active amplification of the response. Because you know why? These hormones, when they are secreted into the bloodstream, they are in very minute quantity. Some of them are micrograms, very tiny quantities. Yet their physiological effects are very strong and widespread all over the body. For example, muscle contraction and all of that. Sometimes maybe a snake can bite you, just release a tiny poison into your bloodstream that will paralyze your whole body. So you see how powerful the resultant is because of amplification. Each step that you are seeing, 7 steps like this, in that domino, I think it's 13 steps. In each step leads to amplification of the response. It amplifies. As it goes from one step to the other, it amplifies it, goes another step, amplifies it. It's increasing the number of proteins that they are activating, which now leads to a very powerful effect. So one tiny, small quantity of hormone can have a powerful effect on several cells. That is why you have those many steps for amplification process. Okay? All right. So now the next thing I'm going to be talking about is the remaining two. Okay, the cytoplasmic receptors and the nuclear receptor, which are under intracellular receptor. They are very easy to understand. So, cytoplasmic, they are all what? They are all the steroid receptors, hormones, sorry. Steroid hormones, you know them, aldosterone, progesterone, testosterone, estrogen. Steroid hormones, they are the ones that are cytoplasmic receptors because they pass through the cell membranes because they are steroids, they are lipid soluble. Okay, so the same thing happens, they just pass through, go inside the cell and directly activate proteins. Okay, they lead to activation of proteins directly. You don't need to go through all these several, they don't need second messengers to do any job for them. Then nuclear receptors. Some of them too can still go and later bind to the nucleus, okay? So, but some others, they just activate proteins inside, some go and bind. But nuclear receptors, thyroid hormones, which you say they have nicknames T4 and T3, okay? They go directly to activate genes in the nucleus. You see that? And what do genes do? They lead to the expression, the synthesis of protein. We call it gene expression. When something, a gene needs to be expressed, need to come about, can be physiological function and even transmission of heredity, inheritable characteristics. They are all proteins. Proteins are the structural, functional molecules of life. Okay? Your structure like this, that's why your meat, animals, they call it proteinous. When you're eating meat, protein, everything protein. So this is what happens. They go down there to the nucleus and activate certain genes that will now lead to transcription through the normal route. mRNA, they come out, transcription, and then transfer RNA, they work together with ribosomes to couple amino acids together that lead to the synthesis of new proteins. So what happens is that this step, nuclear receptors, they take time. Their physiological functions, they take time because they go through the process of synthesis of new proteins, expression of genes. So that they take some time before they, I don't like all these ones that once it just binds to the hormone, through these steps, amplify and it leads to action very fast. So these ones are slow, okay? Just know that proteins are behind all the physiological for. You just need to know the step it needs to activate. So when we are now discussing each of these different hormones, we'll be mentioning their mechanism of action, which is the specific process of their signal transduction. This is just to give you a general overview, an idea of mechanism of action of hormones. I hope you understand it now. So I'm going to see you in the part three. We still have the final introductory part of this. Don't miss it. See you in the next video.